We have discussed a number of circuits, including all the basic amplifier topologies, using the device that is known to us, which is the NMOS transistor. Okay. Now, a few things we were not yet able to make. One of them is a current source. Okay. We can make a current source, but that current source only draws current. We don't have a device that will push current. It turns out that we can also do that, not by resorting to any new circuit tricks, but by using a different device, which is the dual of the NMOS transistor. Okay. And this device is known as the PMOS transistor. Are you already familiar with these? Have you, what stage are you in solid state devices? PN junction. Okay. So now N, and we are moving to the P side, that's all. Okay. So, you know that there are two types of charge carriers, electrons and holes. So, in case of NMOS transistor, we have electrons as the carriers. We have an N-type channel and then electrons as the P carriers. In P-type, PMOS transistor, we have holes as carriers. Okay. But again, we will work with the models for which we don't need to know that much physics. Okay. Now, we already know the NMOS transistor. We have the drain, source and the gate. The current flows from drain to source, and it's primarily controlled by the gate source voltage, and to some extent it's also influenced by the drain source voltage VDS. And we know all the equations that relate the drain current to the gate source and drain source voltages in different regions. Okay. The PMOS, the way it is normally drawn, there is a reason for this. The source is drawn up. Usually, there is no rule for this. That's because we would like currents to be flowing from top to bottom and voltages to be increasing up the page as we draw it. Okay. And this is the drain, this is the gate, this is the source. As with NMOS, the terminal with the arrow is the source, and arrow is pointing the other way just to indicate the different polarity of carriers. Okay. And the main thing is that the current flows from source to drain. Okay. And there are many ways to express, I will write down the equations for the current in the PMOS transistor, many ways to write it, and if you do, if you check different textbooks, there will be different ways of doing it. You could first of all have ID defined in the same way going into the drain, but have it attain a negative value, right? But we don't do that. We would like to keep all the variable values positive. So what I'll do is I will describe this in terms of VSG and VSD instead of VGS and VDS. As far as the large signal characteristics are concerned, we will use the source gate voltage instead of the gate source voltage. And similarly, source drain voltage instead of a drain source voltage. Okay. This will let us keep all the quantities positive. But any other description that you see, you should be able to easily translate. Okay. For instance, I could write everything in terms of VGS here, but then VGS value would be negative, that's all. Okay. So that's all that's there. You can see that it's just exact counterpart of the NMOS transistor with the polarities of voltages and currents reversed. That's all. Okay. The equations also follow the same thing. So only remember that when we say ID, with when the large signal ID, the total ID, when in a PMOS transistor it is flowing from source to drain, and in a NMOS transistor it is going from drain to source within the device. Okay. So we know the expression for the expressions for ID. It is 0 when the gate source voltage is less than a certain voltage known as the threshold voltage. And here now we have two types of transistors. We have to start distinguishing between the parameters of the two types of transistors. So I will call this VTN, sorry, not VTP. And similarly, there is a threshold voltage for the PMOS transistor. If VSG, the gate source voltage, so source gate voltage, is smaller than the PMOS threshold voltage, the transistor will be off. Okay. That is, you had to maintain a certain difference VGS for the transistor to turn on. Here you have to maintain a certain difference VSG for the transistor to turn on. Qualitatively, it's the same thing. Is it okay? And we also know that when VGS is greater than VTN, there are two possible characteristics. One, when VDS is smaller than VGS minus VTN, that is, then the equation is mu n C aux W by L VGS minus VT times VDS minus VDS square by 2. Okay. So, this is the condition. Essentially, this is for small values of VDS. Okay. VDS has to be positive according to our definition. Similarly, for PMOS, VSD has to be positive. So, this is what we have for the NMOS transistor. And in case of PMOS, we have mu p C aux WL. Mu p is the mobility of holes. VSG minus VTP. By the way, here I should put VTN. VTP times VSD minus VSD square by 2. Basically, it is the same equation. Okay. Instead of VGS, I have VSG. Instead of VDS, I have VSD. That is all. Okay. And finally, for large voltages across the device, I mean this is VDS, voltage across the device, similarly this is VSD, voltage across the device. For small values of the voltage across the device, the transistor will be in a triode region or linear region, right? And for large voltages across the device, it will go into saturation region. The NMOS equation was mu n C aux by 2 W by L VGS minus VTN squared. This is for VDS greater than VGS minus VTN, and similarly here we will have mu p C aux by 2 W by L VSG minus VTN squared, VTP squared, thanks. Yeah. Okay. So, you can turn on the transistor by having a sufficiently large VSD above the threshold voltage, and if you short the source to drain, still no current will flow. As you increase the voltage VSD, current will start increasing, and at some point it will saturate to a constant value. Okay. So, that is the saturation region. So, qualitatively you can say PMOS and NMOS are exactly the same, and what will be different will be the parameters. Mu n will be different from mu p, and VTN will be different from VTP. Okay. So, which is, do you know about mu n and mu p, which is larger, which is smaller? Mu n is larger. The free electron mobility is higher than the mobility of holes. Okay. So, this is true. Now, VTN and VTP are kind of arbitrary. I mean, in a given process, one could be slightly higher than the other or less than the other. And there is some interest in having them equal. Okay. That's because then when you make digital gates, you will have symmetric characteristics. So, typically the aim is to make them equal in a CMOS process. CMOS means complementary MOS process, which includes both NMOS and PMOS transistors. Okay. So, VTN and VTP will be equal, but not necessarily exactly the same. Okay. And in our case, in case of an NMOS transistor, we consider devices with positive VTN. That is, you actually have to apply some voltage to turn on the device. And similarly, we will our PMOS devices will have positive VTP. That is, you have to apply some voltage to turn on the PMOS transistor. Okay. Now, these are not the only choices available. In a process, you could also have this threshold voltage close to 0 or sometimes even negative. Okay. That means that if you short circuit gate to source, there can be some current flowing in the drain. Okay. If you apply sufficient voltage across the drain source, right? So, that means that you have to apply a negative voltage to turn them off. So, there is a whole range of devices like this, but the mainstream technology has devices with positive threshold voltages, that is what we will assume. Okay. Is this fine? So, So, yes? No. VDS equal to 0, there will not be current. Because VDS equal to 0, still you will be in the triode region, right? Or, you will be in the triode region. So, there will be no current. Okay? So, only when VDS becomes positive in an NMOS or VSD becomes positive in a PMOS will you have any current. That's kind of easy to imagine. You can still imagine a resistor. If you have 0 voltage across it, there should be no current. Okay? So, MOS is the same thing. You should have some voltage across it for it to carry some current. The only difference between resistor and this is that resistor, the current is proportional to that voltage. In a MOS transistor, it's not. Initially, it will change with that voltage and after that, the change will be very small. Okay? And finally, just like with NMOS, we know that this is not quite true. We have an extra factor 1 plus lambda n VDS. Similarly, with PMOS also, we will have 1 plus lambda p VDS. VSD, yeah, again, I keep messing this up. 1 plus lambda p times VSD. Okay? So, you can say there is no difference at all qualitatively. The numbers will come out to be somewhat different. And by the way, I use the symbols W and L here and also here. It is assumed that this is the W by L of the NMOS transistor and this is for the PMOS. And if you want to be more precise, that refers to the NMOS transistor in question and this is for the PMOS. Okay. Now, let us say that we have a process in which VTP is VTN, okay. And also, we know that mu p is going to be smaller than mu n, that there is nothing you can do about that, okay, because the whole mobility is smaller than the electron mobility. But you could make the PMOS transistors wider than the NMOS transistors, okay. For instance, you can make mu p C aux W p by L p to be the same as mu n C aux W n by L n. So, because mu p is smaller than mu n, you have to use wider PMOS transistors than NMOS transistors. If you C aux will be the, I mean that we can assume to be the same in a given process, because there is a semiconductor layer and after that there is an oxide and it is the same oxide for NMOS and PMOS. So, at least at our level of discussion, it will be the same. Okay. Only the difference is that in an NMOS transistor, you will have a polysilicon on one side and N-type semiconductor on the other side. In a PMOS transistor, you will have polysilicon on one side and P-type semiconductor on the other side. Okay. Across the same oxide. Same? Yeah. So, when you specify a geometry, let us say 65 nanometer CMOS, the minimum, usually that refers to some minimum dimension, not necessarily the minimum length of the transistor, but minimum length of the transistor will be close to that. Okay? So, you can assume that the shortest channel you can have for both NMOS and PMOS is 65 nanometers. Okay? There is some small variation there. Sometimes it refers to how closely you can space two metal lines. But all those things will be related. It is not that you will have two metal lines very close to each other, but the transistor minimum length is much different from that. It will also be close to that. Okay? So, it is basically a limitation on what you can fabricate. Actually, that fabrication process is quite fascinating, because now the size of these, when you come down to tens of nanometers, what is the wavelength of light? I mean, how do you know how these things are made? Usually, you shine light on some glass plate, glass mask, and then that will cast a shadow and that will make a pattern and those patterns can be cut. But that is, of course, that is the geometrical optics view of things. For that to be correct, the feature sizes have to be much more than the wavelength of light, but we are already in a regime where it is smaller. So, the actual stuff that you draw to get a rectangle will be quite weird. You can go and check that out. Okay. So, the actual shape on the mask that is drawn so that it finally comes out as a rectangle, it will be some bizarre shape, because there will be all kinds of diffraction and so on. So, anyway, by the way, why I mentioned this is, if you do this, then PMOS and NMOS characteristics are the same, right? Because the this whole thing appears as a product in all our models. If the threshold voltages are the same and these things are the same, then let's say for 3 volt VGS, you are getting 200 microampere saturation current in NMOS. For 3 volt VSG, you will get 200 microampere saturation current in PMOS. Okay. So sometimes you do want a symmetric behavior from NMOS and PMOS. That also can be done, and that is done by using PMOS transistors that are wider than NMOS transistors. So the ratio of the widths has to be the same as the ratio of mobilities, or the inverse ratio of mobilities. Okay. Is this fine? So just to drive home the point that the characteristics, there is no essential difference between NMOS and PMOS. The only thing different is the polarity. Okay. The voltages are reversed and currents are also reversed. Is it okay? Well, one of the are you familiar with inverters and so on, CMOS inverters? No, you have not done them. And so the way you make, well, I don't know, we will come to that later in the class. So one common requirement is that when you have a logic gate, so the 0 to 1 transition has to be just as quick as 1 to 0 transition. You would like that symmetry. Okay. So if you want to do that, the 0 to 1 transition is, if you use the standard CMOS logic, the 0 to 1 transition is caused by a PMOS transistor pumping current into the output capacitor, whereas the 1 to 0 transition is by the NMOS transistor drawing the current from the output capacitor. Those currents have to be the same if the rate of change has to be the same. So in that case, I mean, typically when you make a CMOS gate, it's common to see PMOS devices bigger than the NMOS devices. It's not likely that you will make them exactly, I mean, you will make the rise and fall exactly symmetric, but you would want them to be symmetric in many cases. Okay. So that's one of the cases, and sometimes it may be true in some analog circuits also. We'll see. We'll come to those things. So just as a quick exercise, so let's say we have mu p to be 25 microampere per volt square. Mu n I had been taking to be 100 microampere per volt square. The ratio of mu n to mu p can be anywhere between 2 and 4, and sometimes even 1. I mean, this is a very technology dependent thing. Okay. So please sketch ID versus VSG, assuming saturation. And also ID versus VSD for different values of VSD. Okay, please do this. This we have done for NMOS many times. Actually, all it involves is a rescaling of the y axis. That's all. Sorry, yeah, this is not mu p, mu p C ops. In fact, I would also say that W by L is 1. Okay. Plots are no different from that of the NMOS, right? For ID versus VSG, you know that ID will remain 0 up to VSG equals 1 volt. And after that, it rises and you will have a parabola because we assumed saturation region. And for VSG of 2 volts, VSG minus VT will be 1 volt. Okay. So the current will be mu p C aux W by L divided by 2. So this will be 12.5 microamperes. Okay. And for 3 volts, it will be 50 microamperes. For 4 volts, it will be 112.5 and so on. So if you remember the characteristics of the NMOS, you can see that the only difference has been this value of mu p C aux, which is 1/4 of the NMOS value. So it's the same as the NMOS curve you had before, but with the y axis scaled down by a factor of 4. Okay. And ID versus VSD, also quite simple. For VSG of 0 and 1 volt or any value in between, the current will be just 0. For VSG equals 2 volts, it will be in triode region up to BSD of 1 volt. So it will be this inverted parabola which reaches its peak at 1 volt, and after that it remains constant. And the value of course is this 12.5 microamperes. And for VSD equals 3 volt, the saturation triode boundary is at 2 volts and it will look like that. Okay. And for this is for VSD of 3 volts, this is 2 volts, and for 4 volts you will have at all. So as far as the large signal stuff is concerned, NMOS and PMOS are exactly the same except for polarity reversal and everything. The current flows in the opposite direction, the voltages are also in the opposite direction. Okay. Any questions? So let's say to bias NMOS transistor, you are doing this. This will bias the NMOS transistor with a VGS of 3 volt and a drain source voltage of 4 volts. For a PMOS, you would have a similar picture but with reversed voltage polarities as far as the terminals are concerned. That's all. Sorry. This is. Okay. This establishes VSD of 3 volts and VSD of 4 volts. Okay. So, like I said, if these two transistors were such that mu p C aux W by L was the same as that for the NMOS, it's exactly the same current would be flowing there. Okay. Is this fine? So, setting up the operating point you should be able to do now, and even we will come to that. But all the other types of operating point circuits we had, all the other schemes we had for setting the operating point at a constant current, you can still use the same. But of course, the polarity of everything has to be reversed. Okay. So if you are pushing current to the drain node, you would have to pull it from the drain node and so on. Okay. Is this fine? Now, of course, we can start from PMOS and derive every circuit from scratch, but that's not worthwhile doing, because we have already done everything for NMOS. So we would like to leverage that and reuse it for PMOS. Okay. Now before we can do that, we have to derive the small signal picture of the PMOS transistor. Okay. And assume that there is some lambda as well in saturation region. So the characteristics would be okay. So this is the saturation region. Okay. Now I want you to derive the small signal model . But in the small signal model, I would like the variables to be VGS, which is the increment in the gate source voltage, not VSG, okay, VGS and VDS, and ID, which is basically incremental current flowing into the drain. Okay. Now, I know that you can easily do it in terms of I can add VSG to this, lowercase VSG, lowercase VSD, and lowercase ID. But there is a reason why I want it this way. I'll explain that. Okay. So that means that the increment here would be VSG, of course, and the increment there would be lowercase VSD. And I define this lowercase ID to be the increment flowing into the drain. So the incremented current is ID minus ID. That's all. Okay. So that's my definition of the incremental drain current. Okay. Because I'm defining the incremental drain current to be flowing into the drain, the total current would be, the total current is flowing from source to drain. Okay. So it will be uppercase ID minus lowercase ID. Okay. So what I want is from this derive the small signal model that will relate these. Okay. Obviously you will have a two port model with VGS on one side and VDS on the other side and so on. Okay. Please do that. Obviously signs are very important here. Okay. Because some variables have opposite signs of the others. So please mind all the signs and derive the model. So first of all, there are many ways to do this, like I said. The equation, the large signal equation we have relates this ID to this VSG and VSD. Okay. And if I take, so I have ID to be some function. Okay. And let me consider an increment I naught here. Okay. So clearly we know that if it is like this, if I just consider increments in every one of these quantities, I know that I naught is the partial derivative that I calculate from this expression at the operating point times VSG plus the partial derivative with respect to VSD also at the operating point times VSD. Okay. And I have to make the equivalent circuit. At the gate, we have an open circuit because IG is 0. And this I naught is the incremental current from source to drain. Okay, and it has two terms. The first term is it goes from source to drain and it is dependent on VSG. So if this is the incremental VSG, this will be okay. So that's what represents the first term. The second term, what does it say? The current from source to drain is proportional to the voltage from source to drain. So obviously it's a positive, it's a resistor of this value, okay? Or it's a resistor whose conductance is this value, okay? This is a conductance of value dou ID by dou VSD at the operating point. Okay. Now, this current here, the incremental current will be I naught. Okay. Now, what did I want? I wanted my definition of ID was minus I naught. Basically, I said ID flowing into the drain like that. Okay. And that you can see will be this quantity at the operating point times minus VSG, okay, plus this quantity at the operating point times minus VSD, okay, and this is the current that flows into the drain and comes out of the source of the device, okay. And what is this? This is VGS and this is VDS. Okay, you can see that now the small signal model is exactly the same as for the NMOS transistor. If we use the variables ID, which is the incremental current into the drain, and also VGS and VDS. Okay. And the equivalent circuit is also exactly the same if we use VGS. This is conductance equal to that at the operating point, and this is this partial derivative times VGS. Okay. And in this case, this is the gate. This is the drain and this is the source, and I have drawn it in the same way that I do the NMOS small signal model with the drain at the top and source at the bottom. Okay. This quantity here, this partial derivative, this is defined as the GM of the PMOS transistor, and this is the GDS of the PMOS transistor. Okay. So, the large signal characteristics, I defined all the quantities in the opposite direction so that they all come out positive, but the small signal model I define in terms of the same quantities I use for the NMOS transistor. So, the only thing you have to remember is that everything else is okay, it is just a flip of polarity, this VGS and VDS, but this ID, the large signal ID, it flows from source to drain, but in the small signal model what we call ID, that goes into the drain of the transistor and comes out of the source. Okay. So, then NMOS and PMOS pictures look the same, okay, and in case of the small signal model it is exactly the same. Now, there is some reason to do this, that is because see, when we synthesize some function, let us say a control source or something, we do it in the small signal domain. Okay. Now, if the small signal picture of NMOS and PMOS are the same, it is very convenient because we just use this picture, synthesize whatever function we want with this. And we can later decide, we have now an additional degree of freedom whether to use a PMOS transistor or an NMOS transistor, and that is again greatly helpful while designing complex circuits. First you can design some functions, okay, let us say you have some circuits, I mean for instance just for illustration, that day we said that we can make a voltage controlled voltage source of gain more than 1 using a voltage controlled current source followed by a current controlled voltage source. Okay. Now, there is no reason that both of them have to be implemented using NMOS transistor, either one or both could be PMOS also, and that may give you that will give you more choices, right. For instance, especially when you are direct coupling circuits, when you are not using AC coupling capacitors, you have to make sure that the bias voltage of one is compatible with the input bias voltage of the other. If you have both NMOS and PMOS, you just have more choice. So, sometimes you will use NMOS, sometimes you will use PMOS. Okay. Is this fine? So, that also means that we do not have to repeat the whole exercise of all the circuits all over again. We can start from the small signal picture of every circuit and then just establish the operating point of the PMOS correctly and you implement the same small signal picture. Is this okay? So, small signal wise the PMOS and NMOS are exactly the same. Okay. And the only that happens because we defined this incremental ID to be what is flowing into the drain for both NMOS and PMOS, although for PMOS the large signal current is defined in the opposite direction. Okay. Any questions about this? So, let us say I want to make a PMOS common source amplifier. Okay. And I want to bias it with VSG of 3 volts and VSD of 4 volts, and I will take mu p Cox Wp by Lp to be 100 microampere per volt square. That means that this is 25 microampere per volt square, that is mu p C aux, and Wp by Lp is 4. Okay. The reason is, I mean, we can remember all the numbers from the NMOS case and just use them. Okay. Vtp is 1 volt. Fine. And we have been considering this small signal amplifier. Let me omit GDS for now. What is the GM of this device with these numbers? You should not have to think now. 200 microsiemens, right? So, and let us say I have a load which is 100 kilo ohms. Okay. So, how would I make the PMOS common source amplifier? So, please set up the bias, use constant VSG bias, which is not a good thing, but it's a good enough for, it's good enough for a starting point. Okay, and complete the picture. And of course, we know that while setting up bias, you may end up with some additional bias resistors here and there. Okay. This has happened before. Okay. So, we may have to use additional resistors to bias the gate and source. So, what I want you to do is use a, let us say, a single supply of 24 volts and establish the correct value of VSG and VSD and use additional bias resistors if necessary and connect up the whole circuit. Okay.